Bantam Doubleday Dell Audio presents Utopia by Lincoln Child. Read for you by Eric Stoltz. Monday, April 3rd, 7:30 a.m. From its jumping-off place at Charleston Boulevard, above the Las Vegas Strip, Rancho Drive makes a casual bend to the left and heads straight for Reno. It arrows northwest with absolute precision, ignoring all natural or artificial temptations to curve, as if in a hurry to leave neon and green felt far behind. Country clubs, shopping centers, and finally even the sad-looking ersatz adobe suburbs fall away. The Mojave Desert, tucked beneath the asphalt and concrete sprawl, reasserts itself. Spidery tendrils of sand trace their way across what the signs start calling Route 95. Joshua trees, hirsute and sprawling, dot the greasewood desert. Cacti stand like standard bearers to the emptiness. After the frantic, crowded glitter, the gradual transition to vast empty spaces seems otherworldly. Except for the highway, the hand of man appears not to have touched this place. Andrew Warne tilted his rearview mirror sharply upward and to the right, sighing with relief as the dazzling brightness receded. "How could I possibly have come to Vegas without bringing dark glasses?" he said. "The sun shines 366 days a year in this place." The girl in the seat beside him smirked, adjusted her headphones. "That's my dad, the absent-minded professor." "Ex-professor, you mean." The road ahead was a burning line of white. The surrounding desert seemed bleached by the glare, yucca and creosote bush reduced to pale specters. Idly, Warren laid the palm of his hand against the window, then snatched it away. 7:30 a.m., and already it had to be 100 degrees outside. Even the rental car seemed to have adapted to the desert conditions. Its climate control was stuck on the maximum AC setting. As they approached Indian Springs, a low plateau rose to the east, Nellis Air Force Base. Warren glanced at a printed sheet that lay clipped to a folder between their seats. Not far now. And there it was, a freeway exit sign, bright green, newly minted. Utopia, 1 mile. The girl also noticed the sign. "Are we there yet?" she asked. "Very funny, princess." "You know, I hate it when you call me princess. I'm 14. That's a name for a little kid." "You act like a little kid sometimes." The girl frowned at this, turned up the volume on her music player. The resultant thumping was clear, even over the air conditioner. "Careful, Georgia, you'll give yourself tinnitus. What's that you're listening to, anyway?" "Swing." "Well, that's an improvement, at least. Last month it was gothic rock. The month before it was, what was it? Euro house." "Euro house. Can't you settle on a style you like?" Georgia shrugged. "I'm too intelligent for that." Another mile and a half brought them to the front of the lot and a long, low structure with the word embarkation displayed along its roof in Art Deco letters. There were more cars here, people in shorts and sandals milling about. As he eased up to a toll gate, a parking attendant approached, indicating Warne to lower his window. The man wore a white polo shirt, the stylized logo of a small bird sewn on the left breast. Warne reached into the folder, pulled out a laminated card. The attendant studied it, then plucked a digital stylus from his belt and examined its screen. After a moment, he handed the pass card back to Warren, motioning him through. He parked beside a line of yellow trams, then dropped the pass card into his shirt pocket. "Here we are," he said, and then looking out at the embarkation building, he paused momentarily, thinking. "You're not going to try to get back together with Sarah again, are you?" Startled by the question, Warren looked over. Georgia returned his gaze. It was remarkable, really, the way she could read his mind sometimes. The girl lowered her headphones. "Dad, don't do it. She's a real ball buster. Watch your mouth, Georgia." He pulled a small white envelope from the folder. "You know, I don't think there's a woman on earth that would pass muster with you. You want me to stay a widower the rest of my life?" He said this with a little more force than he'd intended. Georgia's only response was to roll her eyes and replace the headphones on her head. He looked at Georgia another moment. Then he sighed, took hold of the door again, and yanked it open. Instantly, furnace-like air boiled in. Warren slammed the door, waited for Georgia to hoist her backpack onto her shoulders and follow, then hopped over the shimmering tarmac to the transportation center. Inside, it was pleasantly chilly. The center was spotless and functional, framed in blonde wood and brushed metal. Glass-fronted ticket windows stretched in an endless line to the left and right, deserted save for one directly ahead. A monorail was already waiting at the loading zone, low-slung and silver, its doors open. Oversized windows curved up both sides, meeting at the transport mechanism that clung to the overhead rail. Warne had never ridden on a suspended monorail before, and he did not relish the prospect. He could see a scattering of riders inside, mostly men and women in business suits. An operator directed them to the frontmost car. It was spotless, its sole occupants a heavyset man in the front and a short, bespectacled man in the rear. Warne let Georgia take the window seat, then slid in beside her. Almost before they were seated, a low chime sounded and the doors came noiselessly together. There was a brief lurch, followed by silky acceleration. "Welcome to the Utopia monorail," a female voice said from everywhere and nowhere. It was not the usual voice Warne had heard on public address systems. Instead, it was rich, sophisticated, with a trace of a British accent. "Travel time to the Nexus will be approximately 8 minutes and 30 seconds." Suddenly, brilliant light bathed the compartment as the center fell away behind them. Ahead and above, dual monorail tracks curved gently through a narrow sandstone canyon. Warne glanced down quickly, then almost snatched his feet away in surprise. What he had supposed to be a solid floor was actually a series of glass panels. Below his feet was now an unobstructed drop of perhaps 100 feet to the rocky canyon floor. He took a deep breath and looked away. "Cool," Georgia said.
"Can you believe this?" said a voice in his ear.
Turning, Warne saw that a heavyset man had walked back through the car to take a seat across from them. He wore a painfully orange floral shirt, had bright black eyes, and a smile that seemed too big for his face. Like Warne, he had a small envelope in his hand.
"Pepper, Norman Pepper. My God, what a view. And in the first car, too. We'll have a great view of the Nexus. Never been here before, but I've heard it's outstanding. Outstanding. Imagine buying a whole mountain or mesa or whatever you call it for a theme park." "So what's your specialty?" Pepper asked.
"I'm sorry?" The man shrugged his squat shoulders.
"Well, you obviously don't work at the park because y'all are riding the monorail in. And the park hasn't opened yet, so you're not a visitor. That means you gotta be a consultant or a specialist, right? So is everybody on the train, I'll bet."
I'm in robotics," Warne replied.
"Robotics?"
"Artificial intelligence."
"Artificial intelligence," came the echo. "Uh-huh."
He took a breath, opened his mouth for another question. "What about you?" Warne interjected quickly. At this, the man smiled even more broadly. He put his finger to one side of his nose and winked conspiratorially.
"Dendrobium giganteum."
Warne spread his hands. "Sorry?"
"Orchids," the man sniffed. "Thought you might have guessed when you heard my name. I'm the exotic botanist who did all the work at the New York Exposition last year. Maybe you read about it? Anyway, they want some special hybrids for the Athenaeum they're building in Atlantis. And they're having some problems with the night bloomers and gaslight. Don't like the humidity or something."
He spread his hands expansively, knocking both his and Warren's envelopes to the ground.
"All expenses paid, first-class ticket, nice fat consultancy fee, and it'll look great on my resume, too."
Warne nodded as the man retrieved the fallen envelopes, passed his back. That he could believe. Utopia was supposedly so fanatical about the accuracy of its themed worlds that scholars were occasionally seen wandering around, slack-jawed, taking notes. Georgia was gazing around at the canyon, paying no attention to Pepper. Pepper glanced over his shoulder.
"How about you?"
Warne had almost forgotten the slightly built man with glasses sitting behind them. The man blinked back, as if considering the question. "Smythe," he said. "Pyro."
"Pyrotechnics? You mean like fireworks?"
The man smoothed his fingers over the tiny toothbrush mustache that grew in the shadow of his nose.
"I designed special shows, like the recent 6-month celebration."
Pepper leaned a bit closer to Warne.
"So, you think it's true they got a nuclear reactor buried underneath the park?"
Pepper asked.
"Huh?" "Well, that's the rumor. I mean, just imagine the electrical overhead. The place is its own municipality, for heaven's sake. Think of the juice it must take to keep the whole place going. Air conditioning, rides, computers. I asked one of the hosts back in the center, and she said they used hydroelectric power." "Hydroelectric? In the middle of the desert? Hey, look, there it is."
The monorail had just banked around a particularly steep bend, and ahead, the canyon widened dramatically. Stretching from wall to wall, from the top of the canyon to its base, was a vast copper-colored facade, glimmering brilliantly in the morning sun. The only break in the facade was 2 tiny squares dead center, near the top, where the monorail tracks entered. Along the upper edge was the single, huge word, Utopia, in letters of some mica-like substance that winked and glittered, appearing and disappearing with the angle of the sun. Atop and beyond, a huge geodesic dome arched over everything, a complex lattice of crystal polygons and metal webbing. At its apex, a flag rippled, the stylized logo of a violet bird on a field of white.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.